All right, good evening. It's 6:30. This meeting will come to order. I would like to welcome you to the Pasco School Board meeting this evening. Thank you for attending and for your interest in Pasco Public Schools. Understand that while it may appear at times that the board is moving quickly on important matters, we have had plenty of time to study these issues either in earlier meetings, study sessions, or in board workshops, which are all open public meetings. Each director has had sufficient time to ask questions and obtain satisfactory answers from district staff or through their own independent research. As directors, we each strive to understand all of the issues brought before us and to make decisions that we believe are in the best interest of all the students in Pasco and the taxpayers who provide funding. Board study sessions, board meetings, and all open public meetings are recorded for broadcast on PSC TV, Charter Channel 191, and the district YouTube site. And finally, we're fortunate to my left to have three student board representatives from three high schools with us. They cannot legally vote on issues, but they're a very important part of our team and the board's decision-making process. They participate in many board activities and functions throughout the year, and they are vital in helping us keep our focus on putting students first. So next we have the flag salute. We have Livingston Elementary Principal Scott Rabb here.
President Lehrman, board members, and Superintendent Whitney, thank you very much for giving Ruth Livingston the opportunity to have students come and lead the flag salute today. Tonight, I'd like to introduce the students who have come with me. We have Carly Bowman, Mario Castaneda, and Aiden Miller. Sorry, please rise.
So Mr. Rao, are these students part of a leadership team, or how are they selected to come this evening?
These students, I forgot to say that, sorry. These students were chosen for demonstrating teamwork, perseverance, and hard work, all character traits that we appreciate at Livingston and want to encourage in all our students. At this time, we'd also like to recognize their parents who brought them here. If any of their parents are here tonight, if they could please stand.
Well, thank you for coming, students, and showing perseverance and leadership at your school. We're excited to see young leaders come here, and hopefully someday you'll remember when you hit the high school grades, 11th and 12th grade, you can apply to be on the board, the school board at that time. Like these three students to my left here, you can come and give input to the adults. I'll use that term liberally here. But you can come give inputs to the school board that is here at that time and continue your leadership in this school district. Thank you. Next, we have roll call. I'll have Ms. Smith call the roll.
Mr. Christensen?
Present.
Dr. Richardson?
Present.
Ms. Lanchin?
Present.
Ms. Lace?
Present.
Mr. Lehrman?
Present.
Mr. Mendoza?
Present.
Present.
Sir
Neff.
Present.
Next, we have approval of the meeting minutes. I'll entertain a motion.
Mr. President, I move to approve the regular meeting minutes of October 11th, 2016.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to approve the regular meeting minutes from October 11th, 2016. Those in favor, please say yes.
Yes.
Opposed, no. Motion carries. Regular meeting minutes from October 11, 2016 are approved. Next, we have the agenda review.
So there are no changes to the agenda from when it was posted. We are requesting an executive session under 4231101B for land purchases. We're anticipating it will take approximately 30 minutes.
All right, item number six here is audience comments. In just a moment, I'll invite audience members up for comments. All comments and any questions will be noted. If you ask a question and the board does not provide a response and you'd like additional response, please ensure that your contact information is left on the sign-in sheet in the back left corner there. If you have a question or comment, general in nature, this is the time to bring that up. If you have a question or a comment related to items number 8 and 9, which is reports and discussion and action items, I would ask that you wait until that time, and I will again open the microphone to discuss those issues with the public. Please limit your responses to 2 minutes. When the yellow folder is held up over here, that means you're a minute and a half into your comment, and when the red folder is held up, please finish your thought, and we will continue. We will ask for additional input and respond back if you're not able to get the response that you'd like. So with that, the microphone is open for comment.
Good evening, Superintendent Whitney, President Lehrman, and members of the board. I'm Deidre Holmberg. I'm the principal at Rosalind Franklin STEM Elementary here in Pasco and have been a district employee since 2004. I'm here for one purpose tonight, and that is to give a huge thank you to Superintendent Whitney. As you guys know, we had a health care crisis in our district this week with Ms. Stingley, a principal at Stevens, and with one phone call, and I don't even know if I hung up on Michelle or if we said goodbye or whatever, she said, "What can I do?" And I said, "Handle school." And with that one phone call, in less than 10 hours, a team was put together, people were informed, staff was taken care of, students were taken care of, I was taken care of, and Ms. Stingley was taken care of. She cleared her schedule for days, and I just can't thank her enough for the response that was caring, consistent, and fantastic. Thank you, Michelle.
Thank you. Thank you to Ms. Whitney, and I see other staff out here that has stepped up, so thank you to everyone who's stepped up, and we appreciate the operational excellence and the service to our students and their families. Seeing that we have no more audience comments, we'll move on to agenda item number 7, which is board communications. We'll start with Dr. Richardson.
So recently I visited Markham and Maya Angelou and visited with teachers and staff, and grateful for the opportunity to visit their schools and get input and feedback. I was sad to miss the 10 ways to survive a zombie apocalypse. I had a number of friends that were in that play, and I was out of town at a work conference, which does relate and overlap with the work we do in education. And so I tried to think about ways that the knowledge I was gaining can help in our school district. So I'm grateful for that, but I sad I missed that and the community forum while I was out of town. But.
So it's been a fun couple of weeks. The community forum was interesting. It was a teacher administration. There were very few community members, I hope, and I decided to take that as a compliment that things were going better, as we haven't had quite as many. But it was a wonderful opportunity to get to interact with teachers, get their viewpoints, and tour once again Curie, and see what the great things that they're doing there and the incredible unity that you feel there at Curie. So it was a really wonderful opportunity. I'm glad we took it. Despite the low turnout, I feel like it was still very valuable. And then got to go to the Pasco Chihuahua game. You know, really impressed with the players, largely the sportsmanship, and the, you know, it was really fun to see Pasco High School's dance team and their band. They are phenomenal at that, and I think it was just a fun evening, and it was fun to view that despite the uneven scores. I hope that gets more even over the years. So so yeah, that was a fun experience.
I just wanted to thank everyone for their efforts and for putting on the Curry Community Forum and for allowing us to tour Curry at that time and seeing how when the bond is passed how where the expansion will be. And they did a great effort. And I was sorry for the low turnout, but it was a great opportunity for us as well. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. So I was able to attend the Chiwana Open House this last Monday, October 17th. And it was a really great setup. We had lots of colleges come and lots of clubs that were able to kind of display what they do. And I was able to learn a lot, even after being at Chiwana for it's my fourth year now. I was found clubs that I didn't even know were even existed. Like we have a Rubik's Cube club now, so that's exciting.
I was there too. They have a Wii club. It's not a Wii club. It's
a gaming club.
Anyway, it was interesting.
So all different activities and clubs that are really cool and a lot of students can get interested in. And I guess unlike board member Richardson, I am prepared for the zombie apocalypse now after seeing that play. I was able to go see it and it was a great play, really good production. And so that was really awesome to go see that at Pasco High. And I also was able to go to the cross country districts and it was cool to see, even though it rained and I didn't bring a jacket, it was really good, a really good experience. And a lot of them PR'd by a lot. So it was really good to see that. And
Hello, everybody. Well, this week was Spirit Week at my school, New Horizons, and it's been fun. Even though we don't have a dance or anything at the end, we just do it for fun, and it's been great. We also had a coat drive, and that's been going really good. I'm amazed at how many sweaters are being donated. Really proud of my school, and I see a lot of good happening in the future for us. We are planning dances for Christmas. It's going to be kind of a surprise. I shouldn't even be saying that, but I said it. And we're working toward the future, and I see a lot of good happening. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. So a couple of weeks ago, we saw a new thing, which I mentioned last time, was Bulldog Way, where at our early release, we have bunch of students stay after school and collaborate with teachers. So I attended that and I thought it was really nice experience because so different students got into groups and went into different classrooms and each classroom had teachers from different subjects. So I went to like the science department and so we collaborated with the science teachers and we talked about like what is our bulldog way and how do we want to demonstrate and stuff like that. So that was really nice. And I also went to the gravel pit game and I agree with Amy. It's such a fun night. It doesn't matter who wins, who loses. It's just the energy you feel there. I love seeing people run down from the stands after the game and start dancing. That's always a fun experience. And then I also went to see the play, but I went last night because I was a part of the Haunted Hallway, which was before. So different clubs put up tables and gave out candy to the people walking in or to little kids as well. And so I was jumping from different tables because I'm in a whole bunch of clubs. So, but anyway, it was really nice. And I got to dress up too. And so hopefully I didn't scare any little kids. But yeah, and then today we had an ASD meeting. So we were just talking about budget and kind of proving how we're spending the money. And because we have our Spirit Week this week and our homecoming is this Saturday. And we'll, like always, we have our homecoming game and parade before, so Friday night. So I'm looking forward to that. And apart from that, go Pasco.
I attended the WASDA regional meeting a week or so ago where we had some reports on some of the things that are going on around the state. Actually, we also heard about the Richland is doing a new healthcare high school or something like that. I don't remember. I left my papers at home that had all that information. But so there was a report on that. The planning principal came and talked about what they're planning there. It sounds like that'll be an interesting project. MJ Bolt was there from the State Board of Education, talked about some of the things that they're doing. I think the big thing, the focus right now is on the putting together the state program for ESSA. And she is always reaching out. I don't know if other board members are on her email list, but always looking for information. I know I've got some requests from her. But it's worth, if you have any interest in the things that she's asking, then it's worth responding back to her, because she is our representative on the board, or one of them from the eastern side, and is always looking for feedback. Tricia Lubach also talked about training, some training opportunities. WASDA Leadership WASD is coming up in the next year, and so they're looking for people to do that if anybody is interested. And then Tim Garchow was there, the new executive director, and he's quite a character. But anyway, I think he's a great asset to WASDA. I think he'll do a great job representing us or our association. Also attended the community forum, and I also want to thank those Valerie Aragon, who offered her building. I shouldn't say offer, I'm sure we commandeered that building, but for hosting that. And then afterwards, meeting with her, she took us on a little tour of the building. Her and some of her staff were there. And even though we've got this brand new building that you would think is, and it's a big building, even in that building, they've had, she showed us a couple of places where they had to take their staff workroom, and now it's converted to a small classroom. And I think it was one of their music rooms is now a classroom, and the music meets on the stage. And I'm sure that's common throughout our district. Unfortunately, we don't have extra space, and so again, just a new appreciation for some of the space challenges that we're facing as a district, and the critical nature of this upcoming bond, that we need to make sure that we get out and do what we can to be successful there, so that we can add to our classroom inventory. And then finally had the opportunity this last weekend, opportunity I should say. Well, I guess it's an opportunity, responsibility. I'm on the Director Area 11 representative to the WASDA Legislative Committee, and we had our last meeting of the year last Saturday. So I spent the day over in Olympia meeting with other representatives from around the state on that committee. And we had elections for the upcoming year, and again talked about some of the things that we've done over the past year and ways to improve that, trying to increase our attendance and participation in the legislative assembly. And also, just fellow board members, so you know, my term on that committee is ending in November. We'll get a chance to elect a new representative. Not saying that I wouldn't run again or accept that again, but regional meeting is coming up, and we have elections for different responsibilities in WASDA that we'll vote on in that meeting, so I would encourage your attendance there.
Last Friday, I attended the Chiawana-Richland game. It was a good time, not the result that probably any of us would have wanted there, at least in this room here, but it was a great atmosphere, and the weather was different. It reminded me of the weather I saw when I was a kid playing football, a little wet. My family was in town from the wet side, and they were commenting on the same thing. They thought maybe the wet weather didn't help Chiawana with ball control, but we didn't have an explanation for why Richland was able to hold on to that ball. Good time, though. And I also want to thank the Curie people for hosting us, for setting up. And I was going to read kind of what I read before we had that community forum, because I think it tells, it summarizes a direction that we're setting as a board, and talks about the principles of governance that we're implementing as a board. We're listening. We're holding community forums. We want input from the community. So over the past year and a half, the board's been redefining our governance model using a book as guidance called Good Governance is a Choice. We as a board have identified our owners as the community at large, from young parents to new to public schools, to our valued senior citizens who are our connection to Pasco's proud history of quality education for all children. Every voice in our community is important. As your elected board of directors, we are in service to you. It is our job to listen to all members of the community. This belief has led us to schedule and hold quarterly community forums in addition to our regularly scheduled board meetings and study sessions. We are listening to you and we are implementing ideas from the community. We filter the information we receive to set goals and direction for the district that best communicates the shared beliefs, values, and expectations of our community. The educational experts leading our district will then implement the expectations and directions set by the board, which will lead to improved outcomes for student achievement, customer service, and operational efficiency. The board has identified PSD students and their families as our customers, and we are focused on providing excellent service to these customers. The work being done to define clear roles, responsibilities, expectations, and goals will allow us all to work together toward improved student achievement and will ensure that there is greater consistency and equity across our schools. As a board, we expect the district to be a learning organization that seeks continuous improvement. And the definition of a learning organization is one that facilitates the learning of its members and continuously transforms itself. And as a board, we support and empower employees to be innovative and proactive when solving problems without fear of failure. What we talked about was seamless transitions for children and what we did with school startup this year in order to ease those transitions. After we talked about what steps the district had done, talked about what went right or what we could do better, the next year we opened it up for community voice to bring up topics to the communities of community choice. And we'll continue to do that, and we'll have quarterly meetings. So the next three community forums are posted on the district website. If you're interested in coming and having additional two-way dialogue in addition to what you're getting at the board meetings and study, at least at the board meetings these days, please look on the district website and join us for our next community forum. Thank you.
So I would like to extend an invitation to the first superintendent bus tour of the year. We'll be at Whittier and Curie on October 27th, so this Thursday. If you'd like to be on that list, please email me directly at mwhitney@psd1.org, and I'll make sure you get on the list. There's also a community event sponsored by the Latino Civic Alliance. It's a visioning opportunity on Saturday from 1 to 5. Myself, the city manager, the city auditor, or the county auditor, and a judge will be speaking and engaging the community in some visioning activities around how we can partner together to make the community of Pasco an extraordinary place to live and learn. So again, Saturday from 1 to 5 at the Senior Center, if you are available. I also wanted just to highlight a couple of events that are coming up. November 1st is Career Day at Pasco High School. I'll be speaking at that event. I think it's important for those of us who have a passion for what we do to share that, and especially with our kids. So I'll be encouraging our Pasco High students who are thinking about being educators or principals or maybe even the next superintendent to come home after they go away to school and do that with us. So I'm really looking forward to that opportunity to talk about the job that I have such a passion for. We've also invited Galen Emanuel back to our district on November 2nd. He'll be meeting with our classified staff. He is the consultant who's helping us move forward with our Pasco Promise and building a culture of yes and. So we're excited to offer that opportunity to our building classified and district office classified staff. I'll also be participating in CHS mock interviews on November 3rd, so an awesome opportunity to interface. And I do a fair amount of recruiting at those mock interviews, too. I offered my cards to the Pasco High kids that I interviewed at the Pasco High mock interviews and encouraged them also to come home and work for us. So you can never start recruiting too early is my motto. Then just mark your calendars on November 5th is the state cross country meet. If you've never been to a cross country meet, even if you're not a runner, It is a phenomenally inspiring event. Those kids are just committed to their sport in a way that if you're not a runner, I promise you'll at least run around the block after you watch these kids do what they do. So again, I just highly encourage you, if you've never been, just come once. It's a great event, and so I'm looking forward to that. I also attended
Where is it?
It's at the Sun Willows Golf Course.
The state tournament?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. State cross-country meet is there, and I've heard when I travel around the state, the people really love running that course. So it's a great day. I did attend the zombie apocalypse, so I too am prepared. Really enjoyed myself, and I'm going to just ask for a slight bit of indulgence as I tell a story. I attended the gravel pit football game a couple weeks ago, and I was very neutrally dressed in gray and black. I was very concerned about how I was going to manage that. And I had an extraordinary time watching a community come together around a sporting event. And I have to say, I am a crier. I'm a very emotional person. But at the end of the game, our Chiawana and our Pasco High athletes came together in the center of the field and knelt in unity. And the announcer said, tonight we came onto the field as rivals, but we leave as one because we are Pasco. And I was moved to tears by these phenomenal words of inspiration by the announcer and this statement of unity by our student athletes. And it was a reminder to me why I love what I do so much, and why I just feel such gratitude to be a part of a community that cares about each other and our kids in the way that was very clearly demonstrated at that game. So much more than a football game in my mind happened that night. So I appreciate the board's patience in indulging me with that story.
Thank you. Next, we'll move on to agenda item 8, reports and discussion.
I'd like to welcome Executive Director Suzanne Hall to the podium tonight. Suzanne is going to give us an update on our new sets of curriculum review processes.
Good evening, President Lehrman, Superintendent Whitney, and members of the board. It is my pleasure tonight to provide the report outlining the work of the newly formed curriculum teams for 2016 and 17. And tonight's report will provide you with a general overview of our work to date. And over the next several board meetings, I will continue to report to you in more detail the progress of the initiatives outlined before you. This year, we have a total of 8 different committees hard at work, composed of teachers, specialists, administrators, parents, and community members that are meeting as part of our ongoing curriculum materials review process. Our goal is to provide the most updated, research-based, and appropriate materials for our students. The major tasks for the curriculum committee are outlined on this slide, and they will follow a very tight timeline. The curriculum committees will be responsible for identifying the components for each curriculum area, creating or recommending a scope and sequence, ensuring alignment to district, state, and national standards. The committee will recommend up to 3 curricula to be provided to staff and the community for input, and they will make their final recommendation to the Instructional Materials Committee. It will be the Instructional Materials Committee who will bring the recommendation to the board for action. Here are 8 committees. There are a total of 66 people and counting that are participating. We will be providing a complete list of each committee's members, and that will be added to our website for anyone who is interested in being able to contact and reach out to the committee. Each committee will be meeting weekly. We've met twice already. Agendas, minutes, and other resources will be openly shared with all teachers on our internal S drive, and staff will have access to all of the resources that the teams are previewing and researching for their work. Teachers will also be able to use an email account that we've created, curriculum@psd1.org, to submit questions, suggestions, or ideas. Our goal is to establish an open and engaging process to all our stakeholders. So where are we? We are looking at our first deadline, which will be November 15th, which is 2 weeks away. Our curriculum committees have begun the work of conducting a thorough needs assessment of our current materials. This includes, but it is not limited to, what you see in front of you. Identifying the components of our current program, analyzing our current scope and sequence to district, state, and national standards, evaluating the materials to adequately meet those standards, and developing and conducting surveys with staff and parents. Once this phase is completed, the teams will decide and provide a summary recommendation of which components of the programs will move forward for future consideration. And that takes us to phase two and three. The work of phase two and phase three will include, by December 15th, the committee will narrow the instructional materials considerations to up to three for staff review and study. By January 15th, the materials will be delivered to each site. The goal here is to create opportunities for as many teachers as possible to review the materials and provide input. The curriculum committee will also be designing and offering opportunities for parents and the community and students to provide input as well. By March 15th, committees will develop and present their recommendations to the Instructional Materials Committee. And by April 15th, again, the board will consider these recommendations. Once final decisions are made regarding the instructional materials, the work of the late spring and early summer will be focused on providing the appropriate professional development and recommended instructional materials delivery plan to sites and to staff members. So, while the review and adoption process is underway for these eight content areas, we are still busy developing our curriculum system and frameworks for our English language arts and mathematics programs. As I mentioned in my last report, we had over 120 teachers participate in training on curriculum design, and they are continuing to meet weekly and monthly to develop those units, refine the units, seek input from staff, and make adjustments as necessary. The work is essential to building a systematic approach to ensuring a guaranteed and viable curriculum in the coming years, so that all K-12 subject areas will use a common framework to ensure a foundational experience for all our students here in Pasco.
Do you have any questions or comments from the board?
This is so huge to take on in 2 years. How are our teachers feeling in the implementation process for the English language arts and mathematics? I'm just looking at everything that has to be done, and it just seems huge. Do you survey that? Do you have a good idea of how they're doing and if they need more support, and how our brand new teachers are doing, especially the ones that are having to implement, you know, both curriculums at once, and how things are going?
Yes. Well, we're probably using a variety of strategies to really be listening to where the teachers are and how we can support. One of the ways we're doing that is with the instructional coaches that are each of the buildings. They've been instrumental in being supportive immediately to our teachers, as well as bringing that input around the concerns and what we need to work on next to their monthly meetings. So that system is really working out well. We also have a regularly scheduled curriculum meeting that includes our principals and our teachers on special assignment, that we also talk about what's going well, what can we do better, and how can we get immediate issues addressed. And we have, the curriculum email address that is reviewed daily, so that our TOSAs and our coaches can respond in a really thoughtful manner and in a timely manner.
So, but The whole group was, all of our teachers were trained on this summer, is that correct?
Yes.
Is there going to be any follow-up training for all of our teachers?
Absolutely. So again, part of the role of the coaches is to discern what exactly would be helpful to the teachers, and they are meeting to design kind of mini lessons that they can provide immediate support to individual teachers or to grade level teams. We are bringing in our vendors and our technicians on an as-needed basis and creating opportunities either during the school day or after school where teachers can come and get more support.
Okay, so it's more, right now we're more individual training rather than group training because that's what it seems that the teachers need.
Well, and part of it is the limitation of the substitutes, you know, being able to pull teachers during the day. So we really are trying to use our coaches really efficiently so that they can be in those classrooms and at the elbow and supporting those teachers daily rather than teachers waiting until Thursday of next week so they can go to a training from 6 to 7 at night.
I did have some questions about your staff supporting each committee. Are these a combination of district staff and teachers? Is that what these largely are? Social Studies 8, Science 22. Mm-hmm. And we went up to the number of 22 because I remember they were trying to keep groups small last year. 22, I think, is significantly bigger than the other groups, wasn't it? The English Language Arts and Math from last year, or is that about?
That's about the same size.
Okay.
Yeah, they varied between 22 to 30.
Okay.
On the ELA and math.
How did you decide that? And
we went, worked collaboratively with our association in terms of advertising which committees would be available and an application process. It was the same process that was developed the year prior. And then we met, and it was our goal to have as many people included and able to participate as much as possible within the parameters of what the agreement was.
So do you oversee all of these groups?
I have a wonderful team that helps. Okay. We kind of have a conquer and divide. We meet constantly to make sure we are sticking to the process and the timeline and providing a quality experience for the committee members.
Okay, great.
So what are you going to do next year when this is all done?
I'm sure Michelle Whitney will fill my time.
Well, this is a huge undertaking last year with the two major curriculum and now this this eight individual curricula. It's huge.
Yes. I will say that the people who are on board are very excited, enthusiastic. They have expertise in this area, and they're just taking it on and just working very hard.
Oh, good. I can only imagine that after one big year and now having to do another one, especially where it's eight of them individually, it's kind of hard to track. But we're hoping it goes well and look forward to further reports.
Okay.
We sure appreciate all the work that you've done and all the work our teachers are doing in implementing these curricula.
Are you able to quantify these eight committees, the amount of time that it's going to require of them to get the job done? Is it more than the committee spent last year, less or about the same?
I think it will vary. I think the science and social studies will still be in the same ballpark as ELA and mathematics because it's such a K-12 content focus and scope. I think the art, technology, leadership, those committees will move a little bit quicker.
Okay. And more or less we're on the same, the high level goals you put there, same timeline as what the committees hit last year?
Yes.
Any other questions from the board? Thank you, Ms. Hall.
Thank you.
And now I'd invite the community, if anybody has any comments that they'd like to pose toward the board, the microphone is open. Seeing that we have no community comment, we'll move on to the next report.
I'd like to welcome Assistant Superintendent Eric Bowles to the podium. He'll be providing what is a continued series of data presentations to help frame the work of the district.
Good evening, President Lehrman, Superintendent Whitney, and members of the board. Thanks in advance for being able to share a little bit about this topic of adverse childhood experiences, or ACEs, this evening. As Ms. Whitney indicated, this is the third of a series of presentations really designed to set a baseline for how our PASCO students are achieving, and will enable us to make the adjustments that we need to make internally to ensure that our kids have the very best opportunity to persist through school and through higher education should they choose, and through their career. The issue of ACEs is one that many of us are passionate about. And like many of us, I have learned more about what causes human behavior, I have adjusted my approaches, beliefs, and practices accordingly. If we define human behavior as everyone's best attempt to deal with the situation at hand, I think that definition will really help set the stage for the rest of this presentation this evening. So you may recall the last time I presented, we talked a little bit about, you know, where kids perform. This is a national study, where kids perform over time based on where they come into school in general. Not that there aren't plenty of exceptions to this rule. And there are a variety of reasons why kids start behind. Tonight we're gonna explore a little bit around the research around ACEs and how adverse childhood experiences can impact a human life over time. So the definition of adverse childhood experiences include a variety of things. I'll mention just a few: physical and emotional neglect or abuse, emotional abuse, mental illness of a household member, divorce or separation of a parent, domestic violence toward a parent, or incarceration of a household member, just to name a few. The more exposure to ACEs a child experiences, the more likely they're to experience the rest of these things on the pyramid over a lifetime, which can include, as you can see, ranging from disrupted neurodevelopment and, in the worst case scenario, early death. And I promise this will take a more positive turn, just setting the stage here. And so here's another way to look at the issue. The more ACEs a child experiences, the more likely that child is to show up in our school systems with developmental delays. Another way to look at it, and this is a study out of Spokane Public Schools, teachers reporting students with academic problems or issues correlated with the amount of ACEs that the children reported experiencing. So just kind of another way to look at the same thing. I was able to take a look at our PASCO School District Healthy Youth Survey results. The last time that survey was given was 2014. It's given every 2 years. We're currently in the window again. And there's a lot of data in that survey if you take a look. So I tried to boil it down to one slide. I thought, so what impact can a school have? And I'll spend a little bit more time talking about that later on. But I just really drilled into school protective factors. The blue bar is opportunity for pro-social involvement. So, you know, things that get kids jazzed about coming to school. And for most of us, when we went to school, we think back, you know, a lot of times that's the co-curricular stuff. It's not necessarily a hardcore academic subject area that gets us super excited to get out of bed in the morning. And then the brownish bar is students' perceptions around rewards or incentives for that pro-social involvement. And so we know that just one or a handful of positive interactions or experiences can really help kids build resilience. And so this is an area that you know, we may want to focus on in terms of a district. When you think about how you might track that data at the high school level, is probably the easiest example. You know, the number of students enrolled compared to the number of students experiencing at least one co-curricular experience. You know, the more we have the ability to, you know, study that issue and bolster that participation, you know, the more likely our kids are to stay with us.
Shows success here? What are we trying to do? Raise the brown bars or blue bars or both?
I think success would be you're raising both bars so that kids would perceive there are more opportunities, and you know, you receive kudos and accolades for participating in those opportunities. No matter what they are, no matter what your passion. And we heard, you know, some commentary earlier around the real diversity of clubs that we see, in particular large comprehensive high schools, you know, just helping all kids find some niche that really motivates them to engage in school in that pro-social way. So I promised you we'd get some good news. So one supportive relationship can make the difference and build the resilience needed to thrive. So again, we've talked a lot about some of the great work the district's done in terms of establishing mentor programs and mentor opportunities for kids. These types of things are really important. There's a number of other really important things to consider. ACEs are predictive. And many of us have experienced one or more ACE as children, but they don't determine our fate. They don't cause brain damage. They cause brain adaptations, and those adaptations build protectors in the brain and a brain that's wired to protect themselves and others from harm. You can actually see, you know, brains changing as kids experience more pro-social opportunities. So I think it's really important that there is a lot we can do. You know, we don't just wring our hands relative to the circumstances that, you know, some of our kids may find themselves in. And so to continue on that theme, want to point out some of the really good work that's been done in the district. This slide comes from an author by the name of Eric Jensen. What really struck me was, you know, when I first really started looking at this work, you know, we kind of take for granted that we come with this whole keyboard or array of skills. The reality is what we're hardwired with are those skills in the middle and the skills on the outside. You hear them referred to oftentimes as soft skills in the research. Those are the skills that really determine ultimately our success in life, probably more than our smarts and a whole variety of other factors. I mean, to the extent that we can get along with folks is oftentimes the extent that we have, you know, successful life and career outcomes. Those skills are taught skills, so there's a lot that we can do. The district over time has invested heavily in training with Eric Jensen and a number of current initiatives, the Birth to Nine initiative, PBIS, which we talked briefly about in the workshop, and Abbott are just a few initiatives that come to mind in terms of really building those pro-social structures and supports for our kids who need our help the most. We're continuing to learn about this all the time as an administrative staff. We're coming together Tuesday, November 1st from 4 to 6 p.m. at the Chihuahua Auditorium to watch a documentary titled Paper Tigers. So that's going to be a good opportunity for us to really begin to learn or continue our learning together as an administrative staff in terms of what we can really do to provide that supportive safety net for our kids who need us the most. And kind of along the lines of just better understanding and empathizing with student behavior and looking at student behavior as the opportunity to, you know, help mentor kids along as opposed to maybe through the lens of a punitive punishment, which is maybe where we've been traditionally. I thought this quote really said it all. So I'll just share the quote with you and thank you very much for the opportunity to present on this topic.
Questions or comments from the board?
I have a question. On the graphs that have the green, the orange and blue, how are there rewards if there are no opportunities for pro-social involvement in grade six?
Great question. So we don't see a blue bar on the graph for grade six. The survey changes. It's given at grade six, grade eight, grade 10, and grade 12. I didn't bother to report the grade 12 data because, you know, we're kind of at the end of our opportunity. So I thought grade 6, grade 8, and grade 10 would be a good place to start. And because, you know, kids are different at 12 than they are at 18, there's a different series of questions. So they don't actually collect that data in the survey around opportunities for pro-social involvement. Maybe assuming that definition would be hard for 12-year-olds to kind of wrap their head around and report accurately. At least that's what I surmise. But there isn't any data for that column because those questions are not directly asked of sixth graders. So that's a great catch.
So it's, you know, it's really difficult to know what I'm very familiar with ACE and ACE scores. just because of some changes that we've had in our family lately, and realizing the impact that adverse childhood experiences have in children later in life. It was fascinating how this data even came to be. As it came from an adult standpoint, people in way later years having major problems and realizing there was a huge, like huge correlation with health problems later in life and these adverse childhood experiences. So it is really interesting, but we don't know what a child's ACE score is. Sometimes even if you're very close to a child, you don't know that until much later. So is this something you just apply to all children to help them get through this so they don't end up in that position later in life? Is this kids that, or do you apply it to kids that you know have a more challenging background? But even then, it can, from all the things I've researched, you can look like a it can look like a perfect family, and a child can still be having major problems. So
yeah, let me try to address sort of unpack each of those. So these impacts certainly cut across all family domains, socioeconomic status, no question about it. In terms of addressing all and each, I think it's important that we have holistic protective practices to the extent we can. We're always concerned about serving the whole child, you know, no matter that child's background. Some of the data keeping that comes with the full implementation of positive behavior interventions and supports, or PBIS, will really allow us over time to drill into, while we're starting to identify a pocket of students who are really having some individual issues, and then being able to directly teach, provide counseling opportunities, networking with our community agencies so that there's a more of a wraparound social work focus over time will be some of the way that that can be addressed. So it really is a focus on all and a focus on each.
Thank you so much for the presentation. This is, I think our initiative or efforts to encourage each of our students to participate in some sort of pro-social extracurricular activity really is a protective effect in this, and really supports what this is getting at. I think one of the most concerning things to me, and this is obviously a sensitive issue because it's so common, is the ACE, parental separation and divorce. And that's hard to talk about because nearly every single one of us probably has a close family member or friend that has been affected by that. And the fact is that dramatically affects the child's sense of self, their behavior, and any behavior is a form of communication, whether it's good or positive, that's their way of communicating. And that's very concerning to me. You know, one of the things I try to encourage families, the best thing they can do when they have a young child is have a strong marriage and family. I don't do a good job probably at that, but that's the best thing they can do for their child is to show that child how to have a good relationship. So I appreciate what Ms. Phillips said. I don't know if we try to identify these children and make sure that they're extra encouraged to participate in activity, like additionally encouraged and monitored to have a mentor or someone that's stable, because if all they see is in their family relationship is dysfunction, how are they going to learn how to interact appropriately with that? It's very challenging. And again, this is a sensitive issue because it affects nearly half of our children. So assuming about half of this room has probably been affected by this, but it's something we really have to address as a society and a community.
Yeah, that's a great point. And I didn't delve into a lot of the statistics, but the majority of adults have experienced at least one ACE in their childhood. So you're absolutely right. It's a pervasive issue that we don't talk a great deal about. And you know, the more we can provide that positive impact for each kid, the greater chance we have of achieving all five of our outrageous outcomes.
On the, if we go to the slide with the emotional keyboard there, I think a statement was we have these initiatives, Birth to Nine, PBS, PBIS, AVID, and there are ways that the district's proactively supporting staff and students to address kids who may be impacted by ACEs. So that's kind of mitigation and understanding the situation that these kids have. But there may be kids who don't have any ACEs in their family, but can be taught all these more directly rather than just indirectly. Do we focus on any of these topics with all children in any of our programs, just talking about humility, forgiveness, empathy, optimism, compassion? Do we do that in any programs that we have now?
Yeah, my understanding is, and if somebody else with more context wants to jump in after I give my explanation, for those of you who are in the audience, I'm new to Pasco as of July 1st, my understanding is a recent change that the district made was our elementary counselors are working delivering direct service to students almost in exclusion, of course, across the course of their school days. So this is being worked on continuously.
I think you also heard Principal Rob mention these students were selected for exhibiting, and he listed, I think, four different characteristics. Many elementary schools, if not all, focus on a character trait or one of these elements that are under the TOT as part of their regular course of business throughout the day, whether it be part of the announcements in the morning or focus that counselors are doing and then principals are reinforcing and teachers are reinforcing. So many of our schools, if not all, do something like that. Or even the initiative that our McLaughlin Leadership Kids talked about at our last board meeting about Dude Be Nice. You know, those are all, if you look at these taught on Jensen's emotional keyboard, those things are connected there.
So I think I heard every kid is getting this kind of education from the counselors, regardless if they've experienced documented ACEs or not. This is kind of, it's not curriculum, but topics that are talked about with every kid in the district.
Right, and you know, it's a great question. So, you know, sometimes it's like, I don't know, it doesn't matter what the question is, compassion's always the answer. You know, some of these taught characteristics are just great life skills regardless of your circumstance or background. You're going to be a phenomenal human being if you can do these things. And then like you're saying, we know our kids, we know, you know, and not always, but most of the time we know those kids that are going through hardships. And so you do focus in a little bit more when you know there's a family situation or a sick brother or sister or et cetera, et cetera.
I appreciate someone bringing up counseling. There's two issues I think that we may struggle with or that we need to address as a board and as a district, and that's that our elementary schools have become so large, and with sixth grade, we may not have enough counselor support at the elementary schools. And one counselor told me that the ideal workload would be between 300 and 400, so that would mean that most of our schools need two counselors, most of our elementary schools need two counselors. And a standardized curriculum for the counselors throughout the district. And those are two things I think we can work on that would help this situation. But I really am sincere in my plea. If people have ideas, or we really need to address this as a society and community, I don't really know of programs or what is being done to strengthen marriages and families. That is the most effective way that we can reach and prevent some of these issues. And I don't know if people just shy away from doing programs that address that, but if anyone has ideas, is aware of programs, I'll get behind you in Pasco to help formulate something to help make that happen in our community.
And just to real quickly address one of the issues you raised, Brian Levitt, who's in the audience tonight, Heidi Thompson and myself are actually meeting to begin to analyze, and we'll have things in place for counselors with heavy input from the counselors around kind of common core curricular resources before the end of the school year. So that's I'm glad you raised that issue, and I agree with you, that needs to be addressed.
Yeah, I really do agree with this. I agree with it happening like more in elementary, middle school times, because when you're little, you know, you get like, oh, mom, why am I sleeping on the couch or something like that? Oh, there's a ghost in your room. Or why is my dad not coming home? Or like, he's on vacation or something like that, you know? But as a kid, you don't really understand. But if they teach you stuff like this in elementary and you start understanding more, and then once you get to high school or something, you'll know what's going on and stop caring about things. And maybe start attacking these kind of things when you're in elementary, you know, like, I don't know how to really put this into words, but like just start explaining things more of life, you know, when you're in elementary more than when you are in high school. I feel like it's already a little bit I don't want to say it's too late, but maybe it is, you know? But I feel like starting stuff like this or anything like counseling or anything for help for the kids, I really do agree with starting it like more earlier years than later on in high school stuff, something like that.
Well, I appreciate that. And I think one of the really important things is our experiences don't define us. And I think the more we understand the context for those experiences, the more we can persevere and live a healthy, happy life. So I appreciate your comments, Jesus.
Well, I also agree with Jesus because there are things that you can be taught, but like hardwire things, it's basically, it goes with your instincts. So being taught is like the foundation of how you're gonna react or how you're gonna behave for the rest of your life. And so like in high school, we have been taught these things already. So once we know them, we put them together. And yeah, it's hard to explain. It's really hard, but I think one of my examples could be the bulldog way. So we were trying to come up with different words that would demonstrate or show how we are or who we are and how we've been taught. And compassion or humility can tie in with like respect or just other words that come together. It's hard, but to explain. But I agree with him, and I think it's the foundation. And without us, you know, it doesn't matter. We have different perspectives. So some people, some families might not have, you know, as hard issues as others. But it's just being taught, having that knowledge is always helpful because you can understand better, you can relate maybe. But definitely knowing is better than not knowing, I think.
I agree.
Thank you, Mr. Bowles. Yes.
Thank you.
Would anyone from the audience like to make a comment or have a question for the board? All right, with no comments from the audience, we'll move on to agenda item 9, action items.
Let's see, where are we at, Mark? I got to get on to the resolution.
Board President Mr. Lerman, Superintendent Whitney, and board members, tonight the district brings forward two resolutions. The first resolution is 931 for the acceptance of the Mark Twain parking lot renovation. The project was part of the 2013 bond and provided additional parking for staff and visitors, a new bus pickup and drop-off area, and a larger parent loading and unloading area. Acceptance by the board begins the final process to release the retainage in the amount of $33,991.65, which includes state and local taxes. At this time, the district would ask for approval of Resolution 931 and acceptance of the Mark Twain Parking Renovation Project.
Questions or discussion from the board?
So is it better? Doesn't your child go to Mark Twain, Scott? Are you liking their new project?
My children attend Mark Twain. Yeah, I think it's a great improvement in safety, something that needed to be done. It's a lot smoother, and like I say, the safety aspect of it was well worth the investment, I think. This was part of the 2013 bond, and I'm excited that that project's complete. Additional discussion from the board? I would entertain a motion.
I move to approve resolution number 931, accepting the Mark Twain parking renovation project as final and complete.
I'll second the motion.
There's a motion and a second to approve resolution number 931, accepting Mark Twain parking renovation project as final and complete. Additional board discussion?
What was the total cost on this?
Mark Klein, about $850,000.
Who was the contractor?
Contractor was Granite Construction.
Thank you.
With no additional board discussion, I would ask Ms. Smith to call the roll.
Mr. Christensen?
Yes.
Dr. Richardson?
Yes.
Ms. Lankin?
Yes.
Mr. Lehrman?
Yes.
Mrs. Phillips?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay, the second resolution, excuse me, is number 932, official acceptance of Stevens Site Improvement Project. This project was the Road 24 abandonment and improvement at Stevens. Acceptance by the board begins the final process to release retainage in the amount of $23,866.83, which includes state sales tax. At this time, the district would ask for approval of Resolution 932 and acceptance of the Stevens Site Improvement Project.
So is this just the parking lot across from Stevens, since the rest of the Stevens Site Project is kind of on hold until we find out if the bond passes or not?
The Stevens parking lot was phase one of the project for Stevens overall. This is actually phase two of that project. Stevens parking lot was completed last year. Okay. This project was to abandon Road 24, which is right behind Stevens, so that access from the Stevens site to the athletic fields would be a safe transition. And before they had to cross the street to get over to the athletic fields and then of course back over again. One of the pluses of doing this project now is whether or not, based on the bond, if we replace Stevens, the road abandonment would have needed to be done anyway. In the 2013 bond, there were site improvements that needed to be done to Stevens in the athletic area, and still that road abandonment would have needed to be done for that site improvements also. So at this time, with that being completed, that's a step that would have needed to take place for either the 2013 bond, if that goes forward to be, the 2017 bond, if that were to be moved forward and be completed, or if the bond did not pass, and we went back and said, we're still gonna go ahead and complete the 2013 bond site improvements, again, that road abandonment still would have needed to take place. So
did you plant that to grass, or is it still looking like a road? What does it look like now?
It's all tore out now. It's all grass. It's all been improved. The street stops and winds around, goes down to Road 26, and then, of course, it comes back. So it's free movement now out to the athletic fields and back.
Great. I'm going to have to notice that next time I drive by.
Yeah, take a
drive by tonight.
So, yeah.
On your way home, just drive right up Road 24, I think it is, isn't it? Mm-hmm. You'll find a stop sign there now.
Yep.
Which I don't understand why they put a stop sign there, because you can only go one direction, yeah, and there's no cross traffic. But
I will entertain a motion from the board.
Mr. President, I move to approve resolution number 932, accepting the Stevens Site Improvement Project as final and complete.
I'll second it.
There's a motion and a second to approve resolution number 932, accepting the Stevens Site Improvement Project as final and complete. Additional discussion from the board? No additional discussion from the board. Ms. Smith, will you call the roll?
Mr. Christensen?
Yes.
Yes.
Mr. Lehrman?
Yes.
Mrs. Phillips?
Yes.
Dr. Richardson?
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Nonemaker. So those two action items were with regards to work that was done from the 2013 bond. At this time, I would invite the public, if they have any comments on these last two action items, to please address the microphone. Seeing that there are no comments from the public, we'll move on to action item number 9C.
So I want to ask a question before we move on this. So we've finished up these two projects. We've got the classrooms at the high school, and then we've got New Horizons.
Mm-hmm.
Does that finish up pretty much the projects for that bond?
Yes, that should finish up, I believe, the 2013 bond. Is that correct? Yeah.
Okay, so we're about done. Good. And I think this kind of leads into the next one. So where did we end up on that with the bond? And that maybe Mr. Bond Counselor is going to have to answer this. Neil, is it?
Jim McNeil.
Jim McNeil. I knew there was a Mac in there and a Neil, but I wasn't sure where. All right. So we sold these bonds for this project already, right? 2013, those bonds have been sold.
Correct.
And somehow the numbers, I don't know if they come out exactly. Do we end up with extra money? Do we have to come up with some general fund money to finish these up? I mean, nobody's that good at predicting what these are going to cost, right?
Well, and generally, you will have interest earnings that will accrue on the bond proceeds in your capital projects fund, and then you'll also have state match that you would have received as well that would then have contributed to the ultimate cost of the project.
Yeah, but so when you sell these bonds, you get all that money at the sale of the bond, right?
Yes, correct.
And at the end of the project, you're either going to have some left over, or you're going to have some, or you're going to have to make up some. Right?
Correct.
How close are we on this 2013 bond? And maybe you don't have these answers right now. I don't mean to put you on the spot. I'm just wondering: are we over, under?
Right now, projected, because again, we're not done with the projects yet. You know, we're projecting, but right now we would look at being under, and we can get you those figures. We can get that information for you. But as it would stand right now, as we're projecting, no, we wouldn't have to take anything out of general fund or anything like that. It would be the bond proceeds would be paying for all the projects.
Okay. Good.
If we have excess, then where legally, where can that go?
That's designated in the bond resolution as it was originally written when we passed the 2013 bond, and any change in that would be a determined by the board for excess funds.
Because really, we're going to have excess funds from the Stevens project because we're holding off on that. Now, we may want to wait to decide, but to me, we would be under because we decided to hold off on that full project.
Yeah, and for how much and everything, I'd need to put those figures together for you. And we can do that.
Well, I recognize we've still got stuff to go. I was just curious if just generally, where are we on that? And we're talking about this next bond tonight and same thing, there's over and under what happens and so.
I think I'd sum it up by saying we're anticipating and are projecting not to be over budget, to be under budget.
Right. And if by some chance we are, then that has to come out of general fund money. Is that a fair?
I'd have to look to Howard. If we went over budget for some reason on the bond?
Right.
There may be other sources as well. I mean, we do have other pieces in the capital projects fund, impact fees, for example. Be careful on how you use those.
Sure.
The general fund would be the most flexible source. Also, it would, of course, hurt our overall operations.
Sure.
Too. So yeah. you know the drill. So,
I mean, we're 4 years out on this bond now. We're, well, I guess 13, 14, 15, 16, so 3 years. And costs change, and so you got to be pretty good at managing that. So
I wanted to make a quick comment about the New Horizon project, which is the one that's still remaining, because I know last year there was a lot of misunderstanding in the community, including among myself. The reason that project has been delayed was because of some unforeseen things at CBC, with them getting a new building and funding and approval for that building, and it really wasn't the district's fault that was delayed. And so if there's anyone with lingering concerns about, well, why have we not done this New Horizons project yet if the bond passed, 3 years ago, that is the reason why. The reason why is because we are gonna renovate a building on CBC's campus that was not available until now that they've built an additional thing. So I just want to make sure that people understand that. And I think most people that were concerned have had that relayed to them, that is the reason why the New Horizons project is not done yet.
Yeah, CBC will be vacating the building. They anticipate sometime in January to allow us to go in. And I'd like to say, just to take a moment to thank Mr. Marsh, because he manages all these projects with his team. very well. So we're fairly confident we'll be in good shape when we get done with the 2013 bond projects.
Great. Thank you, Mr. Nonemaker.
Sorry, Howard. I'd like to introduce Howard Roberts. He will be here tonight to introduce a special guest to present to us Resolution 930.
Thank you, Superintendent Whitney, members of the board, Board President Lehrman, Superintendent Whitney. It's my pleasure tonight to introduce a familiar face, Mr. Jim McDeal, the district's bond counsel from the firm of Foster Pepper. On September 13th, you heard him talk a little bit about the overall pieces of a bond and how it works and a timeline. Tonight, we're considering one of the key elements of that timeline, which is the bond election resolution, as you have before you, Resolution 930. So I've asked Jim to kind of walk through that if you've got questions and whatnot, and then I would like to invite your consideration of passage of this resolution. So with that, I'll take you.
Thank you, Howard. President Lehrman, members of the board, Superintendent Whitney, it's a pleasure to be here tonight. Is a very great segue into the last conversation to jump into the 2017 bond election resolution. As we discussed in the presentation that I gave in September, there really is a three-step process to the ultimate issuance of bonds. The first step is the board approves a bond election resolution, which is what you have before you tonight. Second step is the voters approve the measure, and then the third step is the board adopts a delegation resolution that then ultimately sells the bonds to the underwriter. So we're in the first step tonight, and I wanted just to make sure we can go through briefly summarizing some of the provisions that are key to submitting the measure to the voters. Before I do that, though, I would like to thank Howard and Michelle and Randy, Sarah and Glenda and Kim. It really was a great team effort in just working through all the details to make sure that what you have before you tonight meets with your approval and also is going to be resonate with the voters, and so they understand what is going to be placed before them. So with that, let's just go briefly. I don't want to get too detailed in the minutia, but one of the things, just even starting with the cover page, I think it's important for you to note that we use this cover format so that when the auditor receives the resolution, they can immediately identify it's a bond issue, the title, and they also can see that a nationally recognized bond counsel firm has prepared the resolution, which does hopefully carry some weight with Franklin County. But so that's the purpose of having just even a cover sheet on the resolution. The next section that is important for you to consider is the findings and determinations. We really strive to establish an overall theme to the resolution, and we'd like to make sure that we can carry that theme, whether it's referencing the projects in the summary to throughout the resolution, even into the ballot title. And so Section 1A describes this theme regarding overcrowding, outdated infrastructure, student safety, as being some of the primary concerns that are necessitating submitting the bonds to the voters. We then go to Section 2, which is another important, and Howard, you may have to help me on move this down just so that the public can see some of these provisions. Okay, got it. There we go, got it. So there's Section 1A, then we go down to Section 2, and the goal really in describing the projects is to provide some level of detail, but also recognizing that we're trying to be as general as we can to provide maximum flexibility to you, but also then to make sure that we can be as, you know, provide some substance so the voters understand what they're approving. And Section 2 is really designed to be summarized in the ballot title in Section 9. And again, these are some of the topics that we talked about, so it should be fairly familiar as we go through kind of how we're setting this up for the ultimate ballot title. You'll see also just in note in Section 2, G and H, we have, these are more standard terms that enable you to acquire all the equipment you need to, furniture, et cetera, in the new facilities, and also to pay all the incidental costs related to the projects, whether that's engineering fees, demolition, site improvement costs, all the similar types of expenses that you would undertake. Section 3 is important because the state law requires that you actually ask the auditor to conduct the election on your behalf. Section 4 identifies the authorization to issue the bonds. This section really goes to the third step in the process, what happens once the bonds have been approved. So these are some of the parameters that we establish for the board related to your authorization to issue the bonds. You can issue them multiple series. You can issue them as taxable or tax-exempt bonds or tax credit bonds, depending on your determination, your discretion. And in this section 4, we also see the reference to the maturity of not to exceed 21 years and some other items related to the ultimate sale of the bonds. Section 5 is interesting. It's the intent to reimburse. Our federal tax code requires that you identify if you're going to reimburse yourself for expenditures. Let's say you use some general fund monies to make some site improvements. The IRS says you must have some type of declaration of official intent that you're going to do that. And so we include that in the election resolution to the extent that before the bonds are ultimately issued, you need to go into your general fund. You can do that to make those improvements. Section 6 goes to part of the conversation that you were having earlier, which related to excess proceeds. Should there be excess bond proceeds specifically, Section 6 identifies that you'll conduct a public hearing to determine the appropriate use of those dollars, whether that's other capital improvements, retiring existing debt. But again, all of these contingencies are conditioned upon the board conducting a public hearing, so your constituents have a chance to voice their views on what you're going to use your proceeds for. Section 7 identifies the use of state financing assistance. It's also known as state match. And this section identifies you're going to receive state match or you expect to receive state match and that you'll apply it to complete the projects. And of course, we've defined the projects earlier in Section 2. And our state law requires that you identify the specific projects you're going to be doing with both bond proceeds and state match itself. And this section accomplishes that. It also indicates that if you have excess state matching money, that you'll also conduct a public hearing, again, going back to that same routine that the state law contemplates. I think it's important to note that for generally, we assume that as soon as you issue bonds, you spend bond proceeds first. And so generally, whatever you have left over will be considered state match because that's you're receiving state match as you complete your end of the expenditures of your local share related to the bond proceeds. Then the state kicks in and starts funding, reimbursing you for those expenditures. So again, also please stop me if you have any questions, something jumps up, let me know. Section 8 is another provision that's something that we've included because we see it, I won't say frequently, but it does happen where you encounter a circumstance, whether it's a change condition that requires that you change the projects as approved by the voters. And so this, again, requires a public hearing in order to accommodate any kind of change circumstances might arise. Section 9 is the actual form of the ballot title. If you might remember, in September, I showed you the ballot proposition from the last 2013 measure. This, again, has the same types of provisions in it. Again, the first sentence, as we talked about, the word limits. The first sentence after the word concerning can be no more than 10 words, which this is 10 words. And this sentence really does describe the theme. The theme of the overall bond issue is to relieve overcrowding and improve infrastructure and safety. And so with that, we try to, again, carry that theme forward throughout the resolution. Then the essence of the complete details of the proposition are described in the next sentence, authorizing the district to, you see the description, construct two elementary schools, replace Stevens Middle School by constructing a new middle school on the existing site, construct a classroom addition at Curie Elementary School, make safety, health, security, energy efficiency, and support services improvements, acquire land, and then issue no more than $69.5 million worth of bonds, maturing within 21 years, and then levying the excess taxes to repay those bonds. That's the ballot title. This is what the voters will actually see when they receive their ballots. And again, I really appreciate the conversations that we all had with your team. They did a great job, and we had some interesting conversations about just phraseology and the use of words. The rest of the resolution, Section 10 identifies the delivery of the resolution to the auditor so the auditor can perform its duties And then Section 11 identifies the notices related to the ballot title. I think we talked about that briefly, that the auditor will provide notice to the district related to what the contents look like. I mean, we hope that the auditor is going to print the ballot as the board has approved, and Franklin County is very good at doing that. But occasionally we'll run into an omission or something that needs to be fixed. So without belaboring the point, that's the rest of the resolution. Happy to take any questions that you might have related to the resolution or the process, certainly.
Questions or comments from the board?
You do realize we're putting a lot of confidence in you.
Yes.
We're not attorneys, and I've read through this, and I just I hope it's done right. Not that I don't think it is. I'm just
fair enough.
Thank you for your work.
Well, and I think it's important to note that you're also getting a legal opinion that your bonds are valid, and so that's somewhat of your insurance policy to that extent. So,
it's interesting as you know, the things that we do, our responsibilities, and the things that we sign, and we're putting a lot of confidence in other people and their work. So, but anyway, looks good to me as far as I can understand it. So thank you.
Thank you.
I know you've done a great job for us in the past, and I appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. McNeil. Thanks to district staff that helped prepare this as well. Additional discussion from the board?
Yeah, I just wanted to thank, Mr. McNeil. I think they did a good job on this. The district staff, I especially was grateful that it was brought forward the potential to modify the bond as we gathered additional information and received new information that would allow us to modify the bond that was approved a number of months ago. Certainly anyone that's been paying attention at all knows I'm disappointed in the projects that were chosen. Well, one, just mainly the elementary school number 17 and not a middle school. Even after all of our student board representatives, students from McLaughlin, teachers from McLaughlin, parents from McLaughlin, the athletic director from McLaughlin, shared how, McLaughlin's becoming an outcast in our region due to their size of the grades, their seventh and eighth grades, which were not changed by moving sixth grade to the elementary school. So I'm disappointed. I think I'm not trying to influence the community. I'm trying to represent the community, and that's what I've strived to seek out. In my opinion, from all the feedback we received as a board and that I received personally, the community was supportive of having a fourth middle school on this bond, in addition to replacing Stevens Elementary School 16 and some of the other safety projects that we need. So I'm disappointed. That being said, as a school director, our role is to propose these types of projects. The district did a good job of carrying this out, and Mr. McNeil and his firm, preparing this. As private citizens, we can, as a school director, not being supportive of this doesn't mean that as a private citizen I wouldn't support it. It doesn't necessarily mean that I'm encouraging other people not to support it. In this capacity, we're acting as school directors, trying to represent our community and do what we feel is best. So those are the comments I have.
I would entertain any comments from the community. Seeing there's no comments from the community, I would entertain a motion from the board.
I move to approve resolution number 930 as presented, which provides for the submission to the district's voters at a special election to be held on February 14th, 2017, a proposition authorizing the district to issue its general obligation bonds to the principal amount of $69,500,000 for the purpose of paying cost of certain capital improvements to the district facilities.
Second.
There's a motion and a second to approve resolution number 930 as presented, which provides for the submission to the district voters at a special election to be held on February 14th, 2017, of a proposition authorizing the district to issue its general obligation bonds in the principal amount of $69,500,000 for the purpose of paying costs of certain capital improvements to district facilities. Do we have additional board discussion? With no additional board discussion, I'd ask Ms. Smith to call the roll.
Mr. Christensen?
Yes.
Dr. Richardson?
No.
Ms. Lampkin?
Yes.
Mr. Lehrman?
Yes.
Mrs. Phillips?
Yes.
Motion to approve resolution number 930 as presented carries. Thank you to all the district staff. Thank you for discussion tonight. And thank you to Mr. McNeil for coming out and going through that with us. Okay, next we have the consent agenda. On the consent agenda, we have personnel, warrant approval, Pasco High Phase 3 project change order number 3, overnight student travel from McLaughlin Middle School to the FCCLA State Officer Executive Meeting in Yakima, Washington, approval of license agreement for the Commercial Foods Academy, overnight student travel for Chihuahua High School Speech and Debate Club to Central Valley Bear Brawl Competition in Spokane, Washington, and out-of-state overnight student travel for Chihuahua High School Ski Club to Park City Ski Resort in Park City, Utah. Do we have board discussion? I would entertain a motion.
I move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Second.
There's a motion to approve and a second to approve the consent agenda as presented. Ms. Smith, please call the roll.
Mr. Christensen?
Yes.
Dr. Richardson?
Yes.
Ms. Lampkin?
Yes.
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 Agenda item 11 is future agenda items.
So at our next board meeting, we will be having a study session, and it will be MGT, which is a consulting firm that's going to help us do long-range facilities master planning. This will be a first in a series of study sessions with this particular consulting firm. Mr. Nunnemaker's worked closely with them, and we're really excited about what this will offer us in terms of a long-range facilities master plan. During the board meeting, Mark Garrett will be updating us on our technology plan, and Mr. Bowles is scheduled to come back for a data presentation. We are changing the topic of the data presentation to include graduation and SBAC data. We are requesting an executive session under 4231101B, a land purchases. We're expecting it to take approximately 30 minutes, and we'll be requiring no action.
Thank you for joining us for our board meeting this evening, and we will recess into executive session.